speakers. First of all, Greg Nagy, Professor Nagy, and Kenneth Stone, Dr. Stone, Keith Stone, forgive me. And this is a very unique experience, not only because we have Greg and Keith, but because we're in Thessaloniki. This is the first time we have ventured beyond the confines of the Argolid, so we're a sort of traveling show. Our key theme is crisis, or crises and society, and how a crisis affects the culture, the politics, and the economy of society. Professor Nagy and Keith Stone will be addressing the topic disintegration and reintegration of society in archaic Greek poetry. So I'd like to put the question to both of you as a starter. What causes a crisis in ancient, in archaic society? And what sort of crisis are you talking about?
One reason that it's hard to start is that what we're going to do in the auditorium, and consider this a preview, is to be very intergenerational about our lecture,
right,
in the sense that, yes, we're reading text, that's a lecture, but what we're also doing is trying to say what our own organization, how it responds to social crises, because we have social crises, and I will ask our host, dear Jenny, whether it would be too inappropriate for somebody like me to say, well, I'm coming from a society which is very much in crisis as well. And just to make a note of that, I will not be blatantly political, but the United States is in a crisis as well as Greece is in a crisis. And we had that very much in mind. And therefore, our organization is also in a crisis, because how are we going to respond to what's happening in the world today?
I think that all the world is in the crisis. All the West world, we could say,
yes.
But mostly, in my opinion, it's crisis of values, is crisis of separating technology from humanity.
Yes.
From human sciences. When all these things, these two things, technology and pure science, will meet again,
yes. Yes.
Human sciences,
yes.
This would be better.
Yes.
And I think this is the problem. This is the base of our problem, because we forgot the humanities.
Yes.
And,
beautiful.
I think that your lecture today is on the basement of all these problems. What is enlightenment, for example?
Mm.
What is enlightenment? Enlightenment is to get together science with interpretation and with the human being.
Yes.
That's a class.
Yes.
We should search again some of the principles of alignment, in my opinion.
Beautiful. Yeah. And you can see that our lecture is very intergenerational.
Yeah.
I'm the old one. Then, for example, Lanah and Keith are the young ones. He's pretty young too.
Yeah.
And in our organization, one thing we found is that society is malfunctioning in many ways. And I'll speak about the United States first, is that, for example, the role of women in society is not improving right now.
Mm.
In fact,
it's worse.
It's worse.
Yes, it's worse.
And I never thought I would live to see in my old age a situation where the rights of women are more threatened now than ever before.
Mm.
And I also see terrible things happening to academy, and I'm going to focus not in a politicized way about the brain drain,
mm-hmm,
from Greece, the Republic of Greece, to the United States, for example. Or Another good example, Italy. And I think of those two countries especially, Greece and Italy, because when you see all the very, very, very talented people who hold PhDs and who don't have professorial jobs and who should be entry-level junior professors, and then you see them with no prospects. And then in the meantime, we at the center who try to encourage the careers and support the careers of young classicists, we find ourselves overwhelmed by applications of super talented people. And that's one of the reasons that I managed to persuade my young colleague Lanah to be part of this conversation, this dialogue, because Lanah actually is the primary person responsible for all fellowships, for our fellowships programs, for how to make it possible to have as many people come to the center for a short or a long period of research. And Lanah can say better, maybe this is one of the things I would like for her actually to say, is what it feels like for a very smart administrator to have to deal with so many talented applicants that we can only take a few, and what the human as well as social problem is. And you might want to, we'll preview what you will say.
Yeah, I mean, there's two sides that we saw a dramatic increase in terms of the applications for applicants from Greece and Italy, and it is painful to see, as you say, such talented people. And then those who are accepted, how do we best advise them and support them? What's sustainable in terms of their long-term career goals, and how can just 4 months at the center really galvanize them? Is that enough? What else can we do? They're hard questions.
And just to give another example, not just Greece but Italy, especially during the Berlusconi era, where suddenly Alitalia becomes more important than higher education, and suddenly people by the hundreds lose their wherewithal, and here we are trying to help. And Lanah has invented a wonderful system, what we call entrance interviews, where we speak with the resident person right away. And one of our questions, it's a delicate question, is, well, what are your prospects for next year? And it's heartbreaking to see how many have no prospects. And sometimes with Lanah's magic, we can help, and suddenly somebody finds just that perfect position. But you see what I'm saying is that, in a sense, our own society, our own little society at the Center for Hellenic Studies is in crisis as well.
So may I ask, to go back to your example, you're going to talk about Oedipus Tyrannus.
Yes.
How are we to read this text now within the context of crisis?
Well, what I'm going to do, and with the help of Keith, is to talk about a society that is disintegrating. In the case of the Oedipus passage that I've chosen, how it's not only falling apart, it's sick. And how Oedipus says, I know you're all sick, but I'm even more sick than you are. And all the pain that you experience individually, I experience collectively as what? The king? Well, Sophocles himself decided to call this play, as you very well know, dear colleague and friend, Tyrannos, not Basileus, but Tyrannos. He's Oedipus, the, shall we say, the illegitimate king. Okay? The unconstitutional king. So the body politic who isn't really the body politic. And that is something that I will elaborate on. And because you, dear Anna, now I'll get very personal, where my fellow teacher not that long ago, I will use a clip from a Tennessee Williams play where Richard Burton reenacts, shall we say, what is a very Oedipus situation, but I really needed that. And that's how That's one of the reasons that Keith enters the picture, is it turns out that if you really study that Richard Burton cliff, there are two links we have to make, not only the Oedipus passage, but also a passage from the book of Proverbs in the Hebrew Bible. And I thought, this is also a wonderful opportunity. And Keith should say this, and not myself, but I'll say this part. A wonderful opportunity to be talking to a Greek audience who, if they were raised maybe semi-hemi-demi religiously, will know certain passages and will be very familiar with some things, but maybe in a remote context. And we want to make it very immediate, and that the language of the Septuagint still has an enormous power, and that other cultures, when they quote the Bible through other intermediaries, may be missing some things that a Greek culture will not miss. And that's one of the reasons we should talk about this, is how we have, it seems like anathema, that we have translations of the Greek Bible into modern Greek, just as a little help. But and you might talk about my reaction to the first set of translations that we got, and then how Yannis enters the picture.
Oh, let me see where to start there. You gave me quite a few points of entry here.
Take them all.
Well, the Proverbs passage really encapsulates everything I think that we'll say in the lecture.
Oh, yeah.
It's a perfect image of disintegration on a personal level, on a civic level. Just as you were talking, it reminded me of the famous statement of Aristotle that the human being is the creature of the polis.
Yes, yes, beautiful.
And so this metaphor that we begin with, it compares a person's maybe interior life with the architecture of a city. I think it's very apropos to the Greek context in which we're speaking. In the context of the Greek texts that we're speaking about.
And you know, I was thinking maybe we've been talking a lot, dear Keith. Maybe instead of saying architecture, we should say the building of a city, so that then the unbuilding or the destruction comes home. Sometimes people, when they hear architecture, they think of something static, or thinking something dynamic.
This is an architecture that has fallen apart.
Yes.
It's the fabric of the city.
You don't want the word formation.
How about structure?
Structure.
Structure.
Mm-hmm. Structure. Mm-hmm. A structure that is deconstructed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You like that? You're our expert about art history, so.
Really?
Oh, yes, so really. Oh.
Sorry, but I don't think so expert. Well, I'm trying. What about?
Well, because our big metaphor, our big driving metaphor will be the city walls. And I'm thinking not only of let's say, the city walls of Thebes.
Yes.
And I should say, by the way, Thebe or Thebes.
If it's
Thiva, modern. Well, it's just singular. It's singular. All right, Thiva.
Yeah.
Do you know what the plural means in antiquity? Thiva. That means that the plan of the city was not the Hippodamian one, but it was small suburbs gathered all together, and that means Thiva.
Yeah.
That means Athene.
Yeah.
Okay? That means Aegea.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Not the Hippodamian
exactly.
system,
yes. See, I'm so glad I called on you, because that's exactly what I'm fishing for, is that it's a coalescence, and Keith and I are going to concentrate on two myths about the building of Theba. One is the lyre playing of Amphion. He plays the seven-string lyre, and the walls, the city walls, assemble. So it's a construction by way of song accompanied by the kitara. Okay. The other one is the marriage, and I don't want to give it away, because you'll see there'll be a surprise. The marriage of Cadmos. topmost with his dear wife, his bride, but let's not even say the name, because we'll save it for what happens in the auditorium.
Okay.
But all this going back to Keith, who had many doors to open, another door.
Yeah.
Another gate in the city wall.
Yes.
Well, just as you were talking too, it reminded me that, if I heard correctly, that Thessaloniki itself was formed out of a, maybe not a coalescence of suburbs or villages, but maybe an imposition onto 26 villages?
26 villages, yes.
So it's a synikismos.
Yes, Strabo says so. It was a synikismos, yes. And you know, Thessaloniki was by foundation multicultural.
Yes.
Because all these villages had different populations. For example, there were Thracians, there were Greeks from Greek colonies, there were Frisians, the other people that lived around the Thermaic Gulf. And it was Cassander who took them and gathered all together and made a new city. That means that it was multicultural from the first moment.
I love it.
And it continued to be so, because during centuries and centuries, many people arrived here, and it's the most multicultural city in Greece. Because we had Turks, Greeks, people from all over the Balkans, Jews, a lot of Jews. We continue now to be multicultural, because now we have people, on the 90s, for example, we have many from Georgia, from Albania, from Serbia, and so Romania, and so on. Lately, we have Syrians, we have all these refugees that arrived here. Yes, so we are used to be multicultural. Tradition is like so, and also we have very good food for this
vision. Oh yes, oh yes.
And beautiful, very, very tasty sweets. Because
into the single body.
Yes.
But so Thessaloniki itself and its history is, it's not reintegration as a remedy to disintegration, it's just a history of integration.
And it's just building and building and building. And yes, there are terrible crises sometimes, but there it is. And this picks up on another theme. I think I will mention this part of the surprise. If we can switch to another culture, this is Roman culture, and think of the Latin word moenia, which is city walls. There's another word, munus, which is directly related. And munus is the obligations that you have as an inhabitant inside the city walls. And munus would mean what? Social obligation. Or there are a million ways of translating it, but it shows exactly what we're talking about, which is social responsibility. What happens in a society? What do you give and take from society? That's a munus. And we have words like municipal and all these colorless derivatives today. But when you go back to Roman law, that's what an inhabitant within the city walls both takes and gives.
Could I just add something?
You're the master.
Oedipus Rex, the crisis seems to be precipitated by the sin of one man, right?
Yes.
The miasma.
Yes.
So it's not society at large. It's something that has miasmically spreads. It's pollution.
Yes.
Whereas in Ezekiel, if I understood him right, it's to do with the sins of the collectivity of the people of Israel. The various abominations in the eyes of the Lord.
Yes. Yeah, there's no single kingly figure who combines them all into one.
But what does that mean? Is Ezekiel eschatological? Does he lead somewhere? Or is it... And what is the case in Greek thought, Gwen?
Well, Ezekiel's visions certainly lead somewhere back towards reintegration after the disintegration. but they're all collected images. It's just to continue with that thought that you were expressing.
But I would say, though I take your point, that it seems to be Oedipus himself who has the miasma.
Right.
It can be argued that everybody has the miasma thereby. Mm-hmm. And if we had more time, I would have picked another passage, which is Iliad 1, where it's not just Agamemnon who suffers, and who's obviously both ritually and morally incorrect and flawed. It's the entire Laos, and they're all polluted, and it's very clear that they all have to be purified of pollution before we can get on with the rest of the Iliad. So I would argue that it works both ways. The king is the body politic. If the king is sick, the body politic is sick too. And in fact, it's made very clear in the Iliad. We don't have a passage that illustrates that, but if we had more passages, more time, we would do that. In the Greek evidence as well, the participants are just as disintegrating as the single figure of the king who embodies the body politic, the society that's disintegrating. They're all disintegrating. Mm-hmm. And similarly, mm-hmm. and this I do want to keep as a surprise, in Plutarch, where he talks about the life of Romulus, mm-hmm. there is, shall we say, a really good example of collective sin. Maybe I'll do that for now. We can't have too many surprises. So here it is. Mm-hmm. Romulus, as the prototypical king, is dismembered by his senators. They tear him mm-hmm. limb from limb. And then each one of them takes a part of the body mm-hmm. and hides it in their dress and goes home. Mm-hmm. The flip side is, that's a dysfunctional myth. The flip side is that when a Senate convenes, they mm-hmm. come together again, and then the body is reintegrated, but it's not the body of the king anymore, it's the body that is society. Mm-hmm. But there's a good example mm-hmm. of the primal mm-hmm. sin being all the participants. They're all polluted. They do something that is morally unthinkable, mm-hmm. dismembering, let alone dismembering the king. Mm-hmm. I think of how the French today, any French person, mm-hmm. I'm joking here, and I know you're a Francophile and so on. I would say to Jenny that if you take, for example, the execution of Louis the 16th yeah. and the beheading, yeah. I would argue that the French have never got over that. They can never get over it.
Yeah.
It's easy for the English to get over it. If they're Protestant, it's a Catholic king that's beheaded, so that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But for the French, it's something that cannot be undone. And so there's an example of it.
So you think it's a trauma?
It's a trauma. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's all.
Yeah.
I think that's exactly what a psychiatrist would say. And again, if we had more time, we could develop that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question? In the Bible, how does the society, how does it get purified then? We have an idea about Oedipus. What's happening in the Bible?
There are two answers that I can think of to say. One is that there is a yearly cycle of purification mm-hmm. that takes care of and routine sins, mm-hmm. but still things build up if there are too many abominations.
Mm-hmm.
And the result there is that the divine presence leaves, the land is destroyed, because the land itself partakes in the pollution mm-hmm. caused by the bloodshed of the people, for the most part, the murders that are going on. This trauma is the remedy. It has to be, in fact, it's only foreseen in a vision that one day God will cleanse the land and rebuild the city and return to the land. But very unique and kind of non-systematic solution to the problem.
It's non-systematic in Oedipus as well.
Oh, yes.
The next,
oh,
yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's, and I wish we had all of the Bacchic women, you know, by Euripides, but of course the ending is all messed up in the textual tradition. But I think we would see a lot more purification there too, in the wake of the dismemberment of Ben Thebes. And just going back to the Iliad, because I've been thinking a lot about Iliad 1, it's funny, when I was pursuing this topic just a few days ago, I couldn't remember the Homeric word for purification after pollution in Iliad 1, but it's apolimeneste.
Oh, yes.
I'm using the infinitive apolimeneste. Mm-hmm. And then the dirt that comes off is limata, the nitrilon.
Yes.
Limata. So, what is their sin? Well, first they're okay, because when Agamemnonas dishonors the old priest, and specifically disrespects the tears of an old man for his daughter, that's the real moral problem. And all the Achaei, say, we better do something about this. Okay. But then when Agamemnon says, okay, what we'll do is I'll take this woman from Achilles, and it's not so much what he does, it's how he does it, how he insults him. The Achaeans don't do anything about that. So in a sense, they're all complicit in the chain of events that started from the pollution, because Agamemnon is just compounding the pollution. He's displacing one pollution with another pollution by not just disrespecting the rules of the whole army. Mm-hmm. And they never say, oh no, you shouldn't do that. So they go along, they're complicit. Mm-hmm. And I use the expression, go along. Mm-hmm. So a community sins by going along. Mm-hmm. And by the way, that's why I think I am going to explain why I wear the safety pin.
Oh, okay.
Because it has a symbolism.
I think you should.
Is that all right?
Yes.
Good. Because I don't want to go along with what's happening in the United States now.
Yeah.
Okay. But I'll do it like that.
Yeah.
I won't be a firebrand.
Mm-hmm. So is the message of your text hopeful as regards?
Keith has the answer.
Is there hope in times of crisis?
The text that I will talk about has
hope. Yes. Ezekiel.
And offer resources for hope.
But in our case, and this is where Lanah and I come in, we're going to address how Americans deal with really bad social crisis. And maybe it's not hopeful, but the song culture can be beautiful. Mm-hmm. So that's all I'll say now, but you'll see how this has developed.
Okay.
Would that be a fair? So in other words, it's okay to have heartbreak. Yeah. It's not okay, it's just a reality.
Yeah.
But it's how a society, especially a song culture, reacts to that.
Yeah.
And that gives me hope. And Lanah gives me hope.
Yeah.
How's that?
Yeah,
art gives you hope.
That's it. Art. That's what it is. Art is salvation.
Okay.
People are excited about
it. We agree that
there could be a resurgence of all kinds of things, more political art or punk rock.
Yes,
or
there's
a lot of.
It's exactly what happened
comics,
in Greece.
Political comics here around the.
Yes, I sense there's a flowering of the song culture and art in general.
Song, drama.
So what is it? What is it that when the rose is crushed? I'm not going to use that, but I do like that image.
Mm-hmm. Well, should we perhaps on that hopeful note?
Yes.
And could I just thank the host for this?
Yeah,
thank you.
I would like to thank you for your presence here. It it was a great honor for me to be all of you here in the Archaeological Museum of Thessaloniki.
It's
thank you so much. I'm so delighted.
Thank you so much.
Εκλεκτή προσκεκλημένη μας, κυρίες και κύριοι, αγαπητοί συνάδελφοι, αγαπητοί φοιτητές που είστε εδώ πέρα και λέω ότι είστε αρκετοί και χαίρομαι πάρα πολύ γι' αυτό. Είναι μια ιδιαίτερη μέρα η σημερινή, διότι ξεκινάει, καταρχάς είμαι πάρα πολύ χαρούμενη γιατί έχουμε την τιμή και την χαρά να έχουμε έναν σπουδαίο δάσκαλο να φιλοξενούμε σήμερα εδώ, τον Gregory Nagy. Ταυτόχρονα όμως ξεκινάει σήμερα μία σειρά συνεργασιών με το Κέντρο Ελληνικών Σπουδών του Χάρβαρντ στην Ουάσιγκτον αλλά και στο Ναύπλιο και θα ήθελα ιδιαίτερως να ευχαριστήσω γι' αυτό και τον κύριο Νάρος αλλά και όλο το επιτελείο των συντελεστών από το παράρτημα του Κέντρου Ελληνικών Σπουδών στο Ναύπλιο. Σας ευχαριστώ θερμά για την επιλογή που είχατε να ξεκινήσετε τη συνεργασία με το Αρχαιολογικό Μουσείο Θεσσαλονίκης. Φυσικά δεν μπορώ να εκφράσω παρά μόνο τη χαρά μου για την υποδοχή εδώ ενός τόσο εκλεκτού ομιλητή που θα ακολουθήσει και να σας καλωσορίσω, να σας ευχαριστήσω για την αθρώα παρουσία σας εδώ και να περάσω το λόγο στον κύριο Πετρόπουλο, ο οποίος θα κάνει τα εισαγωγικά. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Πάνω στο συλλογιότατε, κυρίες και κύριοι συνάδελφοι, κυρίες και κύριοι. Η απόψινή εκδήλωση εντάσσεται στην σειρά διαλέξεων που οργανώνει το Κέντρο Ελληνικών Σπουδών εδώ και 9 χρόνια στην Ελλάδα. Κάθε χρόνο το Κέντρο καλεί επιστήμονες και άλλους ειδικούς να μιλήσουν πάνω σε μια κεντρική θεματική. Το θέμα φέτος είναι κοινωνίες σε κρίση, οικονομία, πολιτική, πολιτισμός. Οι διαλέξεις πραγματοποιούνται όπως έως σήμερα στο Ναύπλιο και άλλες πόλεις της Αργολίδος. Στην προσπάθεια του κέντρου να διευρύνει το ακροατήριό του, να έρθει ακόμη πιο κοντά στην ελληνική κοινωνία, αποφασίστηκε η εξάπλωση της σειράς των ομιλιών στη Βόρεια Ελλάδα. Γι' αυτό και ξεκινάμε απόψε από τη Θεσσαλονίκη, στη Θεσσαλονίκη και μάλιστα στο Αρχαιολογικό Μουσείο, κορυφαίο στο είδος του. Ευχαριστώ λοιπόν την Διευθύντρια, την κυρία Ελένη, που δέχτηκε να φιλοξενήσει την ομιλία αυτή. Το θέμα μας, όπως είπα, είναι κοινωνίες σε κρίση. Ζητήσαμε από τους ομιλητές μας να μας βοηθήσουν να αποκτήσουμε ιστορική προοπτική, να μας βοηθήσουν να απομακρυνθούμε, να αποστασιοποιηθούμε από γνώριμες καταστάσεις. Και τους ζητήσαμε να μας φέρουν, να μας βοηθήσουν να αναλογιστούμε διάφορες κρίσεις ανά τους αιώνες στην Ελλάδα και στο εξωτερικό. Προσωπικά με ενδιαφέρει η σκέψη ότι ο αρχαίος όρος κρίσης μπορούσε να σημαίνει καμπή ή κορύφωση στην πορεία μιας νόσου. Για τον Ιπποκράτη μια κρίση προχωρούσε επί το κάκιο ή επί το βέλτιο. Ο γιατρός έπρεπε να φροντίσει να τρέξει την κορύφωση μιας νόσου σε ίαση. Απόψε οι ομιλητές μας, ο κύριος ομιλητής είναι ο καθηγητής κύριος Νάζ, θα θίξουν την θετική έκφαση των κοινωνικών κρίσεων, όπως περιγράφονται σε διάφορα αρχαία κείμενα. Το θέμα τους, η αποσύνθεση και ανασύνθεση της κοινωνίας στην αρχαϊκή ελληνική ποίηση. Disintegration and Reintegration of Society in Archaic Greek Poetry. Λίγες λέξεις, λίγα λόγια μόνο για τους ομιλητές μας. Τι να πρώτο πει κανείς για τον ομιλητή, το μας καθηγητή και δάσκαλο Gregory Nagy. Θα αρκεστώ στα εξής. Είναι κατά κάποιον τρόπο δημιούργημα του Χάρβαρντ. Έλαβε το διδακτορικό του δίπλωμα
στο Πανεπιστήμιο αυτό το 1966. Υπηρέτησε στο Πανεπιστήμιο Johns Hopkins και από το 1975 στο Harvard. Το 1984 έλαβε τον τίτλο του καθηγητή κλασικής ελληνικής φιλολογίας της έδρας Francis Jones και συγκριτικής λογοτεχνίας στο Harvard. Είναι, λέω Harvard, αλλά και Harvard, γιατί έχει γίνει ελληνικό πανεπιστήμιο. Και μέσω του οχήματος του Αριστοτέλειου. Από το 2000 είναι και διευθυντής του Κέντρου Ελληνικών Σπουδών στη Δημόση, του Μητροπολιτικού μας Κέντρου. Μεταξύ άλλων τιμητικών διακρίσεων έλαβε μαζί με το Κέντρο Ελληνικών Σπουδών το Διεθνές Βραβείο Πονάση 2006 για την προαγωγή των ελληνικών κλασικών σπουδών. Το 2010 εξελέγει ξένος εταίρος της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών. Διακεκριμένος μελετητής στον τομέα των Ομηρικών και γενικότερα των ελληνικών σπουδών, ο καθηγητής Νάζ έχει πλούσιο συγγραφικό έργο. Επιτροχάδιν, απλώς αναφέρω, Comparative Studies in Greek and Indic Meter, 1974, το αθάνατο βιβλίο The Best of the Achaeans, 1979, Pindar's Homer, The Lyric Possession of an Epic Past, 1990, Poetry as Performance, Homer and Beyond, 1996, Homeric Questions, 1996, Plato's Rhapsody and Homer's Music, 2002, Homeric Responses, 2004, Homer's Text and Language, 2004, and Eto, The Ancient Greek Hero in 24 Hours, 2013. Όλα αυτά τα βιβλία, αν δεν σφάλω, είναι διαδικτυακά προσιτά στους πάντες. Έχει επιμεληθεί πολλούς συλλογικούς τόμους. Ο Gregory Nagy έχει δώσει πλήθος διαλέξεων στη Βόρεια Αμερική και την Ευρώπη. Τα βιβλία και άρθρα του, καθώς και πρόσφατα κείμενα διαλέξεων του, είναι προσβάσιμα στην ιστοσελίδα του CHS. Είναι υπέρμαχος πραγματικός της χρήσης της τεχνολογίας στην εκπαίδευση και στις ψηφιακές ανθρωπιστικές σπουδές. Δεκάδες χιλιάδες σπουδαστές από την Ελλάδα και όλο τον κόσμο έχουν παρακολουθήσει το μαζικό ανοιχτό διαδικτυακό μάθημά του με τίτλο «Ο αρχαίος Έλληνας ήρωας». Ο έτερος εκ των ομιλητών είναι ο σχολιαστής, δεν θα πω αντιφωνητής, είναι ο σχολιαστής, είναι ο Dr. Keith Stone. Ο Keith Stone έλαβε το διδακτορικό του δίπλωμα το 2013 το Τμήμα Γλωσσών και Πολιτισμών της Ελληνικής Ανατολής του Πανεπιστημίου Harvard. Η διατριβή του εκδόθηκε με τον τίτλο «Singing Moses' Song, a Performance Critical Analysis of Deuteronomy's Song of Moses», Ωστόνη 2016. Στον χώρο της αρχαίας Ισραηλιτικής λογοτεχνίας, θρησκείας και ιστορίας, η έρευνά του επικεντρώνεται στη δυναμική της επιτέλεσης, την performance, σε παραδοσιακά περιβάλλοντα, ιδίως στο πλαίσιο των παραδόσεων, οι οποίες συνδέονται με ιδρυτές. Στα δευτερεύοντα ενδιαφέροντά του συγκαταλέγονται βορειοδυτικές συνηθικές γλώσσες και επιγραφές, η ιδεολογία της γης, η ψυχολογία της κακοποίησης και του τραύματος στα βιβλικά κείμενα και η αρχαιοελληνική μυθολογία και λατρεία των ηρώων. Αν επιφέρω λοιπόν, παρακαλώ στο βήμα, ήδη είναι στο βήμα, τους ομιλητές, τον καθηγητή κ. Gregory Nagy, να αναπτύξει το θέμα «Disintegration and Reintegration of Society in Archaic Greek Poetry».
Κυρίες και κύριοι, είναι μια μεγάλη τιμή για μένα that I am speaking to you here. Notice how I quickly changed into English because I want to be as precise as possible in communicating to you the seriousness of our title, Disintegration and Reintegration. Disintegration and Reintegration of what? Of society. we're in a crisis, and we're in such a big crisis, as my dear friend and former student, Yannis Petropoulos, has pointed out, that the first analogy that comes to mind when we think of crisis is sickness. And Yannis had that beautiful definition, working definition of crisis in terms of sickness and then the hope for turning something that is worse into something that is better. That, you know, it's beautifully said. Now, for me to speak before you, I would feel disintegrated if I didn't reintegrate myself with people in my Omada, the CHS team, the Center for Hellenic Studies team. And you notice that there is some measure of gender balance as well as generational balance when you see the two young people surrounding me. So what I propose to do is not so much give you a lecture in the Anglo-Saxon sense of me speaking at you, but a lecture, a reading of some of the most beautiful moments in ancient Greek song culture, or if you like, verbal art in general. And that gives me the opportunity to pay special honor to our dear friend and host, Dr. Jenny Belemi, who to me represents an ideal in the response of society in crisis to where to go from here. And when I think of your work, dear Jenny, it gives me hope for reintegration through art, and that includes through theater. So we'll try to be theatrical here. We will be dialogic. And you heard my dear friend and former student, Yannis, describe the career of Keith, who is a teacher like me. In fact, Keith and I have taught together the course, thank you, the course, Ancient Greek Hero in 24 hours, 8 years, 8 years. I'm surprised he's still young. But the other side, which is equally important for what I do as director of the Center for Hellenic Studies, is the administrative side. And that is represented here, and I'll do my own introduction to you here, Lanah, by Lanah Koelle, who is, the title doesn't tell the story, but her title is, Fellowships Programs Manager, right? What does that say? It says, let me tell you the truth, that this young person handles all visits and residences by all scholars, or as I like to say, researchers, teachers who come and go, not just in the United States, but world over. So she is the boss, really, at the Center for Hellenic Studies. But I want to emphasize especially, and we'll see how this works, her role as not just the administrator of a small society that is trying to help society, but as somebody who therefore experiences all the crises that we as a group experience, maybe even more directly than anyone else in our Omada. So with that introduction, you see how the team, the Omada, will play out, and we will be talking to each other, and I will talk less, and I hope my colleagues will talk more, and we will interrupt each other. We will not allow the slide to go from one frame to another until all three of us give permission, because there's so many things to say. But that will also mean that, for example, Lanah, who will be the button lady, will specifically say, all right, Greg, you've talked enough on that. Let's go on to the next slide. And by the way, I'm wearing on my lapel a safety pin. You see, what is he doing? If the safety pin falls off, will my jacket disintegrate? in a way it will, but we will explain later, and Lana or Keith, one of you, before we finish, will urge me to say what the symbolism of the safety pin is. I think some of you know it already, especially those of you who heard about the reaction to the Brexit vote. So it happens on both sides of the Atlantic. And we, as three Americans, are feeling, I know I speak for myself first, extremely sad and ashamed of what's happening in our country right now. So there's a crisis. Do you understand what I'm saying? I hope I'm not offending anybody by saying that. But we represent an America that is different from the America that seems to be in the forefront right now. And I hope our dialogue will show that. Okay, that's... I think it's time to go to the next slide, if you all agree. Okay, I think I've said enough about societies, that we're talking not only about American society, Greek society, I believe you have crises too. Exactly, tell me about it. And then American song culture, I think that will be maybe the redemption for us Americans. Ancient Greek societies, modern Greek societies, and I like that. Problems besetting all societies, and we are signaling the word besetting, which is a fancy English word, but we will unpack it soon. Before we pass it, do we all agree we can go to the next slide? It's about time, let's do it. Lana, tell about your experience at the Kendo.
Well, this was just, in some ways, this is a small case study of how the Kendo is handling small crises. We're talking about crises in society, and the way that I see that as a fellowships program manager is just so many academic refugees, in a way, looking for hope through our fellowships program, and trying to solve that problem. How can we give people hope and continue to sustain their research and make sure that they can continue to study the humanities, which is so important, especially in this time of crisis.
And sometimes it's frustrating.
Yes. We want to do so much more.
Tell about, for example, the entrance interviews we have. When a resident, whether it's a short-term resident or a long-term resident, first meets us and we talk about, well, what can you do in the next 3 months or what can you do in the next 10 days?
Right, so it's not, we ask not only about their research, but what's their personal situation, what's their career prospects, and how can the center facilitate their work and keep them in the field?
Which is sometimes not easy, and it's not that we have the solutions, but we try and we try and we try.
We have a support network. So this is one example of disintegration and hopeful reintegration from our administrative angle.
Yes. So please keep the word besetting in mind. Yes, the seed of a city. The city as a symbol of society. And then, because I'm a linguist, I love to play with words that are related to each other but don't seem to be related to each other. But moenia is directly related in Latin to munus. Moenia means city walls. But as we'll see, city walls are not only the building of an enclosure, it's what happens inside the enclosure, which is society. So without city walls, there is no society. And in Latin, munus, which is directly related to moenia, is what the inhabitant of a city hopes to give and to take inside the city. Now let me switch without giving you more words. You don't need to have this word spelled out for you, polis. And polis, of course, the Greek word, as Aristotelis says so beautifully, is the context where a human, an anthropos, no regard to gender, a human achieves his or her maximum potential. That's what politikon zoon really means. It's an organism of the polis. It's it's a life form that can exist and can reach its potential only within the city. So you see how city walls are very important to us, because it's an ancient world concept for what society is, what society is contained by, and what are the obligations of participants in the society, both as givers and takers within that society. Social obligation. Are we okay? Are you more happy about besetting? So what we're saying is that the crisis that besets society can be visualized, can be metaphorized in art, in verbal art, by the threat to the city walls. When a city wall is besieged by the enemy, by those who want to destroy it, they will destroy not just the city walls, but the society within. It can also happen, however, from the inside. From the inside. Are you happy? So, dear Key, make sure you turn. Yes, I will. Please pay very close attention to what is translated in the King James Version of the Hebrew Bible as, "He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls."
So here we presented to you many versions of the text. The King James Version, the well-respected and venerable English translation. On your own handout, you have the Septuagint, the ancient Greek, which here is the third, and then a modern Greek translation, and a Hebrew version as well.
Let me stop you, Bruce. Does everybody have a copy of the handout? Good. It may be a raising of hands for who doesn't.
If there are any more.
Okay, so there are a few more. So, and the other thing that's very important about this handout is that, could I say as an old teacher, is don't just read the handout while we're talking to you. But what you could do instead is take the handout home as a souvenir. And now and then, you all know English extremely well. You say, oh, I have to check that word. Okay, go check it, but don't start reading this and forgetting about us on the people. Very important. An old teacher is talking about this. Is that important?
This proverb really encapsulates everything that we're going to say tonight. I think that if you unpack it anticipates all of our messages. Already we talked about the comparison
I like structural better. Architectural sounds static, don't you think, Jenny? Okay.
Structural. Disintegration. And that anticipates the structural reintegration, which will end our presentation.
Yes.
And, well, that's about all.
Okay, that's good. Shall we venture into the next slide? Okay. Now, you knew that we would have a primary Greek analog, and if you like, you can look at the handout and see the modern Greek translation of the ancient Greek. But if you don't mind, I will just paraphrase what is being said here. And the king, who is Oedipus, is saying, I know that you're all sick. I know that you're all polluted. I know you all have a crisis. But that's because I have a crisis. And anthropologists will say, oh yes, he has a crisis because he is a king. And a king is, may I say it, in the language of Enlightenment philosophers, a king is the body politic. The king is the body. And therefore, if the body politic, if the body of society is sick, that means the king is sick. Except, I love the way he says it. I know well that you're all sick, and that sick as you are, when it comes to me, there is not a single one of you who is as sick as I am. All the sicknesses, all the miasmata come together in me. And here, just one thing, in the Anglo-Saxon world, we say Oedipus tyrannos, not Oedipus basileus, because tyrannos is an unconstitutional king. Oh, I think of my safety pin again. An unconstitutional king who somehow comes to power, maybe through illegitimate means. And he's talking like a king, but the question is he a king, especially if he is as sick as he is?
If I can go back to our previous text a moment. Going back to our headline, ancient text, what you've been talking about, Professor Nagy, with...
Oh, is this going to be Professor Nagy? It's Greg. We're supposed to be intergenerational, Keith.
My dear Greg.
Yes, thanks, Greg.
We could apply this, or we could read this proverb in the light of Oedipus and his city. Now, in this version, the biblical version, we see a movement from the city to the person. Now, the English has it backwards. The Greek, both Greek versions, the ancient and the modern, have it in the right order to match the Hebrew, which begins with the city. And that's the predicate of this comparison, which in the Hebrew is a metaphor. In other languages, it's a simile. A city broken down and without a wall is a man who has no rule over his spirit. We see in the case of Oedipus, that the man who has no rule over his spirit leads to this ultimate city that is, well, broken down isn't the metaphor used in Oedipus' dearness. It's more about seafaring and sickness.
Yeah. But we'll see more fracture and breaking later. Yes. Shall we go? Tennessee Williams, most Americans cannot relate to this anymore. It's too old-fashioned, but I've noticed that in general, Greek-speaking people have a much higher cultural literacy about even things like modern American classics from the middle of the 20th century. So I know that many of you know who Tennessee Williams is and know about the play Night of the Iguana. But maybe even you don't know that it was made into a film. And the film is a very bad film. It's so bad that I recommend you never see it, except for the first 5 minutes. The first 5 minutes are sheer genius. And why? It's because the Shakespearean actor Richard Burton, who did questionable things like star in movies like Night of the Iguana, and a lot of it is improvisational, but what we are going to see is a priest, an Episcopalian priest, who, shall we say, disintegrates in front of his flock. I'm deliberately saying flock as the aggregate, the collection of parishioners. And while he's saying what he thinks are the holy words, quoting from the book of Proverbs, exactly as you heard it, quoted from the King James Version of the Bible, as he's saying that, he is disintegrating. And he's disintegrating even in his syntax. And that what happens then is the micro-society of the flock, of the parishioners who are in church, likewise disintegrate and simply get up and leave. And he will say things like, how often do we stray from the straight and narrow? And while he's saying that, that will be a signal because his words are stumbling and you'll hear his syntax disintegrate. And so I think it's a perfect example of not only what he's quoting, which is from the Bible, and you've already seen the words of the Bible, but the entire myth of Oedipus as the illegitimate king who disintegrates along with his people until a purification is found. There'll be words that the Richard Burton figure uses that are so exquisitely timely, where he accuses his parishioners of believing in a god who is simply a cruel, senile delinquent. That's one of the expressions, and it's horrifying to hear the godhead described in a disintegrating society as a punishment rather than as a help. And there'll be so many things that you will observe, including, and I dedicate this observation to Anna Stavrakopoulou, who is a professor of theater at the university here, and with whom I taught many times in the past, and who knows this clip. I think you, besides the people here, are the only one who knows this clip. You might even want to interrupt us and say any observation after they see the clip, because I think it's accidentally that powerful because of the power of the actor. And so this is the part I dedicate to you, Anna, and that is, you have what is called a Santa Claus shot in Hollywood, where suddenly the character is turning towards the camera, and just as in Santa Claus Visits Down the Chimney, and it's as if God were looking at the character who is praying to God, and he's saying, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart always be pleasing to you, my Lord and my God. And you can see that he's already disintegrating, and the words of his mouth will not be bad. And it will just go from there. So watch the masterpiece of disintegration of a person, disintegration of a society, and disintegration of syntax, of the actual language. Okay, here we go.
Sermon for today is taken from Prophets, chapter 25, verse 28. He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls. And I wonder, as we examine our hearts together in this place set aside for worship, how many this year can say, I rule my own spirit? For how weak is man? How often do we? How often do we stray from the straight and narrow? For only when we abide in the Lord are we like cities without walls. Only then can we defend ourselves against Satan and his temptations. We cannot rule ourselves alone. God only is our God only is our help and our salvation. All right, you know. That's why you're here, to see this city with its broken walls. Whenever two or three are gathered together in my name is what the scripture says, but that's not why you're here. Let's change the words. Let's rewrite the order of the morning prayer. Whenever two or three or 20 or 30 or 200 or 300 are gathered together to make whispered comment, to sit in judgment upon the condition of a what? Yes, of a man of God. I said man of God, and I mean it. You all know that your pastor, your spiritual shepherd, is the descendant of a clergyman, the grandson of two bishops. But there were collateral branches to the family that went forth to brave dangers and who were scalped. Men with men's hearts, the wild and free hearts of men. They knew hunger and they fed their appetites. They fed their appetites, appetites that I have inherited. I defy you. Shannon defies you. Get out your tomahawks. Get out your scalping knives. Sharpen your scalping knives. Scalp me. I will not and cannot continue to conduct services in praise and worship of this angry, petulant old man in whom you believe. You turn your backs on the God of love and compassion and invented for yourself this cruel, senile delinquent who blames the world and all that he created for his own faults. Close your windows, close your doors, close your hearts against the truth of our God.
What a start. What a start. And without Richard Burton, none of this could happen. None of this could happen. Anna, do you have any comments? No. Are you stunned into silence, even though you and I have seen this so many times? Okay, then Keith, you must come back to the book of Proverbs.
Well, yes. There are so many resonances here. I mean, there was the shot where, the Santa Claus shot that you mentioned, yeah, where we were looking at Richard Burton, or at the priest Shannon, yeah, and the position of the divine at the altar. And behind him were these giant walls,
yes,
of,
yes,
the church, the structure.
I'm so glad you said structure and not architecture.
And also, I don't know if you ever talked about this before, but the metaphor of dismemberment or of disintegration is invoked here in the form of dismemberment, where he invites the congregation to scalp them, to take them apart.
I made this a surprise for Lanah. Do you have any immediate reactions to this?
No, I was just thinking about the stylistic similarities with you. I was afraid of Virginia Woolf and Dubert, but anyway. but it's very with the city coming apart as everyone's just immediately getting up and evacuating.
Yes, yes. You know. And to hear the city walls, yeah, the walls of the structure, yeah, are that container that is empty. The danger is from within, as you said. It's not guarding against, yeah, an outside enemy, against something that is besetting the community, but it's an explosive. It's not hold together.
So since Anna doesn't want to say anything at this point, maybe during questions and answers, you decide when you want to go to the next slide.
Just one more thing, the metaphor of the pastor, of the shepherd.
Yes, the shepherd of the flock. And the flock is scattered. And we'll see later the expression diasporadim, describing the disintegration of the body of Homer. Ooh, I'm getting ahead of myself.
But about that, as we developed this, I was originally invited to be a respondent, but you shared your text with me, and I began to think of Ezekiel mostly, some very images of disintegration in Ezekiel, and the metaphor of the shepherd comes up there as well. And, I guess I want to say that it's not a typical responding role that I want to take on here as an adversary, but we have this conversation, and we are finding the resources that these traditions have for shaping our understanding of
episode in the first book of Kings or the third book of Kingdoms, depending on how you enumerate the books.
Louder, please.
Can you hear me now?
And keep shouting at us. If you don't hear us, please, that wonderful person who said louder, please, say it again.
Yeah. How about now?
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. So I'll just retell the story a little bit. There is a king, Solomon, who is, we could say this, the man. Does he have rule over his spirit? Well, we'll see. And how does his society fare? His head workman, Jeroboam, is leaving Jerusalem, exiting the city into the countryside. And the prophet Ahijah finds him outside the city. And Ahijah is wearing a new garment, a fresh garment. And what Ahijah presents Jeroboam with, the head workman of Solomon the king, is a sign of disintegration. So right away I can say that Solomon, the rule of Solomon over his spirit, over his city, over his community, is dissolving in its disintegration as well.
A singer, so I thought in the spirit of sharing song culture, let's perform this for you. I fall to pieces each time.
Someone who loved me too, the way that you used to do. But each time I go out with somebody new, you walk by and I fall to pieces. I fall to pieces each time someone speaks your name. I fall to pieces. Time only adds to the blame. You want me to act like we've never kissed. You want me to forget, pretend that we've never met. And I've tried, and I've tried, but I haven't yet. You walk by, and I fall to pieces. You walk by, and I fall to pieces.
That gives me hope. It's just as when certain things happened in our country, the United States, I found hope in going to see the film La La Land. If you haven't seen it, you must see it, because I think it's again a situation where you're despairing of your own society, but then something miraculous happens, and art produces a heartbroken, but nevertheless a deeply redemptive response.
Okay, I would like to remark that we're talking about dealing with integration by means, or disintegration by means of seeking reintegration. And this is a meditation on disintegration, both a couple disintegrating and a person disintegrating, the lover who's the song, not the singer. But there's one suggested way of dealing with disintegration, which is to pretend that integration never happened. Yes. Is that productive? This is a meditation in the middle of it all, so we don't get an answer as to what that.
No answers now. Beautiful. Let's go on.
So this will be an obvious connection, just because we saw the clip from Night of the Iguana and the metaphor here of the shepherd and the scattering flock. The divine figure that becomes the new shepherd, the geographic redemption towards the end. In verse 13 here, you will see, I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries. The word mountains, which is also towards the end of 13 and up above also in 6, these mountains are multiple places. There's another mountain later on in one of our texts, and that place, that mountain, is a mountain of region, where the viewer is set apart from the city, is set apart from themselves, and like this meditation on love that we just experienced, there is an opportunity for seeing a vision of reintegration. The mountains here are different. They are multiple mountains. They are the embodiment of disintegration. There's nothing special about these.
Okay, we can move on. The other great one coming up.
Oh yeah, so this is the first one that I thought of when Greg told me he was talking about disintegration and reintegration. I thought of Ezekiel, and maybe you too have already thought of this one, this most famous scene from the book of Ezekiel. The valley of the dry bones, the vision of the reintegration of the dry bones. And the prophet Ezekiel here has a vision where he sees an entire valley full of disjointed bones. And the question is, how can they live, or can these bones live? The Lord
poses this question to Ezekiel. And then the Lord gives the answer, which is that they can and they will. And we see that the bones come together, the flesh comes upon them, the ligaments, skin, there is no breath in them. So that level of integration is not enough. It's like the creation story in the beginning, where God forms the first human out of the ground, but we have to pause before life truly happens. So what happens next is that the Lord commands the prophet Ezekiel to prophesy to the breath, to the winds, the four winds, in fact. So here, too, again, we see things coming from multiple directions that are dispersed, coming together into one to produce life and reintegration. And the result is individual and communal life, resurrection. These are individuals who come to life, and they form a vast multitude. So we can see here the beginnings of reintegration of the person, the single person in our first proverb, the person who may or may not have rule over their own spirit, and the communal aspects, the city, here understood as its inhabitants, coming back to life again. Perhaps human structures, who knows, being rebuilt. Good. Oh yeah, here's a nice visual. A little, you see the bones in the middle in various places. Three of the four winds, one is missing, perhaps it's coming from our perspective. Ezekiel in the middle, troubled by all of this, not knowing whether they can truly live. But it's happening in front of him. The flesh is coming onto the bones. One difference that I see here is that there's not a multitude. They're still disparate. There's a couple on this corner, the same on the other side. But there's no real large-scale community like we saw in front of the sea yet. But it's coming.
Okay, Plutarch, 2nd century of our era, who manages to tell Roman myths that Romans are too embarrassed to talk about. So this is the only place you will see any reference to this ancient Roman myth. This is about the proto-king Romulus, as in Romulus and Remus, as in the founder of Rome, as in the namesake of Rome. And Romulus, as the prototypical king, guess what, is assassinated by his own senate, a proto-senate. And the assassination takes the form of a dismemberment. He is torn limb from limb. And this is the weirdest part. In the dysfunctional story of the myth, each senator hides a piece of the king on his clothing, in his clothing, and goes home. So they scattered after the disintegration. Each senator goes home, and this is the myth. Flip side, the ritual side of this myth. Myth tends to be about dysfunctional things. Ritual has to do with functional things. The ritual of the convening of the Senate, of the Roman Senate, is therefore a situation where, just as the proto-senators scattered, went to many different directions, each with a body of the king, each with a portion of the body of the king, every time in the present, when the Roman Senate reconvenes, in a sense, the reconvening itself is a reintegration of the body of the king, because, as we saw already in anthropological terms, the king is the body politic. Or should I say, the constitutional king is the body politic, if there is such a thing. I think you're ready to go to the next.
Oh, but I'm not
ready. Okay, go ahead.
In this passage, the previous state of affairs before the disintegration is what legitimates the reintegration.
Absolutely.
So here, in a way, the disintegration is, it's a catastrophe, obviously, but without it, you wouldn't have anything to reassemble. And so here, it's a
spin, you could say, on the disintegration. It's a way of extending the metaphor of disintegration and making it productive for a new form of a community. Before there was a monarchy, then there's a Senate.
Yes. Because the monarchy is dysfunctional and bad, the Senate is functional and good, ideologically speaking. I take your point, Keith. That's absolutely right. But there are many other situations like this. The older I get, the more I see it, that when we're shocked by something that happens in myth and it offends our moral sensibilities, that's the way it's supposed to be. Myth gets it wrong, and then the ritual that reenacts the myth gets it right. And in terms of this scenario, you have to have disintegration before you can get real reintegration. Let's go to the next. So let's talk about a good tyrant, Pisistratos. I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, I know that he's the person who was overthrown by the prototypes of the democracy, so he should be a bad guy. And I'm not taking political sides in this case, but I can't tell you that if Pisistratos had not been overthrown and the democracy that we know and that the Greeks invented had not taken a place of what happened before, we would, I think, appreciate this very interesting myth much more. This goes back to the era of the 6th century before our era. Let's say pre-democratic. And Pisistratos presents himself as a wise ruler here, and in his own words, as re-enacted by the Greek anthology, what he's saying is, "Hi, I'm Pisistratos, and I took the body of Homer." And we know what we mean by Homer here. That's the corpus, the body of texts that are attributed to Homer, namely the Iliad and the Odyssey. I took that body, which had been disintegrated and scattered, sporadim, throughout Asia Minor, which is the home of Homer, and I, the Athenian, reassembled the body, and therefore the poetry of Homer and the integrating value of Homer came alive again. So it's an amazing myth. I'm sorry that it's attributed to somebody that we now call it Tyrannos. But I can say back in the 600s, they did not want to call themselves Tyranni. They were not. It's just that they were definitely, what shall I say, not prototypes of democracy either. So what can I say? I'm interested in the myth, not necessarily in the political agenda of the myth. Fair enough?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go to the next one. This is something that my dear wife, Olga Davidson, has dealt with a great deal and has helped me enormously. And I can say it extremely quickly. It has to do with the idea of the Shahnameh, which is the Book of Kings. And in Iranian myths, what happens is the empire of the Shah disintegrates, society disintegrates, and therefore the songs and the epics about the kings, the so-called Book of Kings, disintegrates. And the metaphor is textualized. It's all as if the oral traditions that led to this amazing mega epic were constituted in a book, and the book itself disintegrated. So here the corpus of poetry is the book. The book disintegrates, and then what happens? A wise vizier, or the wise Shah, sends out emissaries all over the disintegrating empire, and each province of the empire has a fragment of the original Book of Kings. These wise men are then reassembled in the court of the wise Shah, thanks to the efforts of the wise vizier. And they are lined up in the proper sequence, because, ladies and gentlemen, sequence is meaning. And once they're lined up in the proper sequence, each one of them reenacts the fragment that, once you put all the fragments together, becomes the totality, the reconstituted new Book of Kings, which is then the etiology of the Book of Kings. I think I want to leave it at that. I didn't even give it to you on the handout because we are limited in time. And by the way, we're doing well in time. We're almost finished. But I thought that my retelling would be maybe a quicker way of addressing this point. Now, let's go to the next one.
Also, I have another thought.
Oh, absolutely.
This just reminds me, and I didn't think of this in time to include it, but the origin story of the Septuagint itself is quite similar.
Oh, absolutely.
It's not a lost book in this sense, but it's the king of Egypt who wants to acquire a, to him, intelligible translation of the Hebrew scriptures for his library. And the way that it has to happen is that wise men from each of the tribes of Israel have to be assembled in Alexandria to recreate the effectively lost book.
Yes.
His meaning is lost to the king.
But now I have to say something, which is that Keith is talking about a Greek text called the second, well, let's just say the letter of Aristeas. And this etiology, Keith likes to use the Anglo-Saxon term Septuagint, but for you who are mostly Greek-speaking audience, this is the Greek Bible, for heaven's sake. So this is the etiology of the Greek version of the Bible, something that is so foundational for Christian orthodoxy. And the etiology of that is exactly as Keith says, a reintegration of something that's disintegrated, and the miraculous genesis of one single unified text as a result of bringing all these people together. And where are they brought together? They're brought together in Alexandria, which is, as Lawrence Durrell says, the capital of Asiatic Greece, so to speak, or I would say African Greece, because to me and to, I think you, Enimismos transcends Europe. It embraces Africa, embraces Asia, and for me it embraces the world. So this is a very powerful, I think, aspect to the formation of Greek identity today. So there. Sorry for the sermon. I shouldn't preach to Greek-speaking people. You know the value of your own heritage better than I do. I love this. Okay, so imagine India. Yeah, they had a democracy, but they still had a caste system, which I think is such a social crisis, an ongoing social crisis. And so there's this one group of untouchables called the Telugu. They have their own language, and although they have their own oral tradition, they are illiterate, or at least their culture is illiterate, and their oral poetry does not depend in any way on the technology of writing. But because of the prestige of writing in India, especially on the part of the upper classes, especially the Brahmins, it means that when the Telugu etiologize their own oral traditions, even though they don't read and write, their myth is all about a book, a proto-book, which contains everything that they do in oral traditions. And this proto-book was written down by the highest class kind of person in India, a Brahmin. But the Brahmin was disgusted after he wrote down the whole book of Telugu oral traditions. And so he tore up the book and cast it to the winds. Again, I think of the wonderful Greek expression, diaspora. And it means that every time the Telugu people participate in the reenactment by way of oral tradition of their myth, what is notionally happening is a reintegration of a book that never was, and putting together of fragments that never were, but they are when the words come alive again. Okay. Any comments? All right, let's go on. Aren't you proud of us? We're almost at the end. I'm up again. Oh boy. Okay, so this is practically driven my life. I love this so much. It has to do with the song that was sung by the Charites and the Muses, the Muses and the Graces, if you like, at the wedding of Cadmus, the founder of Thema, English, the founder of Theba. And here is what the muses and the hadithes sang. And it goes, Oti kalon philonesti, todu kalonu philonesti. Well, that doesn't sound very beautiful, maybe to us moderns, but this says everything. It is saying, if we analyze what the word philon really means, it's something that is near and dear, and therefore socially cohesive. So in other words, philos, which actually etymologically speaking, comes from the idea of closeness. So somebody who is philos is close, or somebody who is more philos is more close, etc. And the closeness, it converges on the self. I could go on and on forever, but I stop there. So you understand the beauty of the word philos in ancient Greek is that it measures the degree of love. And what the muses and the hadithes, who are the embodiment of not only the pleasure, but the beauty of song, of art, dear Jenny, those muses and the hadithes, they're singing a song that says, what is beautiful, in other words, art, is near and dear, is socially cohesive. So this is a beautiful statement of how art can create society. And what I didn't show you here is that when this song happens, two things are also happening. One is, I'll tell you one first, is that the hero Amphion, who is a master of the kithara, is singing and playing the kithara, and the sound of the music puts the walls together. The walls of the city, of the polis of Thema, are built by the song that is being sung by the proto-hero. And then the other thing is what I'm already saying is, not only is there this song that builds the walls, but then there's a wedding that celebrates the structure of the walls, of the city walls, and that celebration, okay, is the wedding of Cadmos with his bride. And do you notice how I censored the name of the bride? I'm not telling you yet, and many of you know already, but please don't spoil my surprise. Don't ruin the spoiler, or don't read the spoiler. So wait till the next slide, but first let's see if there's any comment from either of you. Okay, then let's get to the next slide. What is the name of the bride of Cadmos, and what is the name of the tomb? It's the same word, or if you like the same name. Are you ready, ladies and gentlemen? Next. Oh, no, I don't want it. No, I don't. I don't want that to spoil it. I want to say it. I'm being selfish. There it is. Anomia. Anomia. And anomia does not mean the modern sense of different pitches coming together. It means the tuning of a seven-string lyre. It means, may I say it in Italian, the accordatura of the lyre, when the tune is perfect, and our friend Plato understood this. When the tune is perfect, then you have a structure that is complete. It is the cosmos. It is the cosmos of social order as well as cosmic order. How do you like that? It's all there. Okay. No, maybe not yet. Maybe not yet. But let's go back. So, In Euripides's let's do it. All right, I'm getting too excited and too selfish. Let's go back to the song. Lana, are there any words in this song that leap at you?
Not necessarily specific words, but the structure and how at the end of each stanza, there's this little twist. There's the disintegration, but then there's kind of a coming to terms with it
yes.
each time, or just we can just make it, but it's just not going to work. So there's it's this kind of dance.
I love it.
Between
yes.
the two.
Maybe the words can come alive again. Who knows?
Yes.
I hope they do.
When we 18 by its heart, and ambitions are low. Resentment rides high, but emotions won't grow. And we're changing our ways, taking different roads. Love, love will tear us apart again. Love, love will tear us apart again. Why is the bedroom so cold? Turned away on your side, is my timing that flawed? Our respect runs so dry, yet there's still this appeal that we've kept through our lives. Oh, love, love will tear us apart again. Love, love will tear us apart again. Do you cry out in your sleep? All my failings exposed, gets a taste in my mouth as desperation takes hold. And it's something so good, just can't function no more. Love, love will tear us apart again. Love, love will tear us apart again. And we're changing our ways, taking different roads. Love, love will tear us apart again.
This just gets me every time. It's just, I'm speechless, but if we go to the next slide, maybe I can recover my words.
this was another singer who had a tragic end. This was about his a relationship that was falling apart. This is the band Joy Division. So this is from 1979, and it certainly doesn't have that sort of deal. But he, unfortunately, the singer
eventually committed
suicide.
I didn't know that. That's Americana.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I had my piece.
Okay. No pun intended. I had my piece. No one said. Okay, so here, you heard the song of the muses already. Here is a shorter version of the same song, and we hear it in Euripides' Bacchic Women. And you know what's happening when the chorus is singing this? Guess what? Even though the chorus is singing, whatever is beautiful is near and dear forever. Or if you like to intellectualize it, art is socially integrating. While this is happening, ladies and gentlemen, off stage, Penthes, the proto-king of Thema, who is the grandson of Cadmos and Harmonia, this king, Penthes, is being torn limb from limb in the dysfunctional mythical world of Thebes in the heroic time, torn limb from limb by his own mother and his own two aunts. So while the song of social integration is happening in the foreground, sung and danced by the choros, in the background, Penthes is being torn limb from limb. The body politic, the king, is disintegrating right there. And the juxtaposition of disintegration in the background, of reintegration in the foreground, is a perfect statement of what Nietzsche would call the birth of tragedy. So here we are, dear Denny, this is dedicated to you, a kind of microcosm, as it were, of theater and the redemptive power of theater, because after all, this particular tragedy of Euripides, and you Greek-speaking people know even better than I, is the swan song of tragedy. It's the last attested tragedy from the classical period. And it's the perfect statement of what tragedy was from the very start. So it's all here. It's all here, and it's all a story of simultaneous disintegration and reintegration. It doesn't get better than that, I think.
So this is my, I guess, final response to our conversation about disintegration and my kind of textual offering of a reintegrated vision to all this disintegration that we saw in the text. And I won't spend long on this three-part text. There's an A and a B and a C. But here in this short first one, we see the mountain that I was talking about, the mountain of vision, the place where you can find the way towards integration. And that's the structure like a city to the south. And there's your favorite word, structure.
I love it. Thank you.
And this vision will follow in a moment. Actually, that's all I want to say about that.
Okay, maybe. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So I didn't show you this before, but this vision here reverses a previous vision of disintegration that Ezekiel had, where the glory of the Lord leaves the temple, the city is destroyed, the glory of the Lord exits the temple by the gates, all of this kind of stuff. I'm not going to go into that now, but the point that I want to make is that just as this vision of reintegration reverses the terms of disintegration, so we have to examine our understanding of disintegration to see whether we can extend it, like with Pentheus, for example, whose his reintegration is powerful. Okay, here's where I want to focus. This kind of painstaking working out of the details of Ezekiel's vision. It's 8 chapters of very laborious measurements of this temple, this city, every aspect of this vision of reintegration, and I'm not going to go through all of those with you now, but you can see that a lot has to go into it, and what I would urge for all of us is that we become poets and prophets, and I should say that most of the prophecy in the Bible takes poetic form, although perhaps ironically not in the book of Ezekiel, where it's mostly prose, but we all should do the painstaking work representing this kind of drawing to examine the metaphors. That's my main point, which I've said about 100 times now. To find the new life and in these metaphors and visions. And if when we perform them, when they come to life, as Lanah has done for us, if they are powerful enough to grant us this integrative vision. That's really it. This final moment is the geographic reintegration of Israel in the city of Jerusalem. And towards the beginning, I gave you this prophetic sign of the garment of the prophet being torn apart into 12 separate pieces and scattered here in the city. Each tribe is represented by a gate. They're all together again. And the very end here, the name of the city from that time on shall be "The Lord is there." The center, the core.
I like the way you said center. And is that? There's no such thing as a last word, but I did try to remember, and I do remember. I wanted to explain why I'm wearing a safety pin. And it started, I think, after the Brexit vote in the United Kingdom. But then when other things happened in the United States, other people thought that this is an important thing to wear. Safety pin is a symbol for those who are expelled from society, who are not integrated into society, such as in the case of the United States, immigrants, refugees, minorities, people of different orientations. And how about this, women? That if you wear a safety pin, you're saying to whoever is with you, is you're safe with me. That's the symbolism. You're safe with me. There are people out there who care about a kind of society that transcends the politics of fear, anger, and hatred. And I know, and I love the way one of the audience said, "Tell me about it." When I said, "You have your crisis, I know, and your crisis is a terrible crisis, and we're here to open our hearts and minds," but just to make it clear to you that people like us, Americans, are in a world, especially today, starting today, where every time we wake up in the morning, we say, no, this can't be real. It can't be the world I'm living in. And for somebody as old as I am, to reach the point where now women are in danger, not just minorities, not just people with exocentric views, is a nightmare. And so what can make up for that nightmare? And I remember when I saw with my white colleague the film Lanah Land, which is about Los Angeles, but it's also about song culture, it's also about Hollywood, which can be terrible, but it can also be redemptive. I immediately sent a message to Lanah, Lanah, you've got to see this. You've got to see this. And that's how, while we were planning this whole event, Lanah became a more and more important part of what Keith and I were trying to do. And I think you should have the last word. I know I'm surprising you, but you say something about how you react as somebody who's a porch singer. That's the American term for what Lanah can do, porch singer. And how a torch singer reacts to the crisis that we all face, and you will have the last word.
Well, one of the things we've talked about is art and how important that is in integrating the story. And there's, I mean, certainly in singing these two kind of, real individual songs, there's a catharsis in that, and we talked, before we had a little preview, we were talking about how much hope there is in art. Hopefully that's come out as well through literature and music and so many other forms.
And there's hope in the congregation that has come together here. You're not a plot, but you're a beautiful, small-scale representative of the cosmos that we're all hoping for. And I know you have the last word, but I guess I can't resist having the last footnote. So thank you very much, everybody.
Ίσως έχουμε λίγα λεπτά για ερωτήσεις. Υπάρχει κάποια απορία, ερώτηση, και αν έχει κάποια καλοσύνη να μας δηλώσετε το όνομά σας, αν θέλετε. Ναι, κύριε.
Όλε.
Oh, I know you. I'm good. How are you?
That was a wonderful speech. I'd just like to say that this reminded me of our discussions in ancient India when we talked about the ancient Greek hero and how he embodies the entire set of elements from which societies have been dysfunctional or disintegrated can be inspired from.
Maybe say it again into the microphone very quickly, a short version.
I think that what happens here is we get reminded of discussions about the Hellenic ancient Greek eros, where he embodies the principles from which a dysfunctional or disintegrated society can be inspired from, the Ritz Armonia.
And you give everybody your name.
George is a double thing.
Bravo, your own.
Ερώτηση. Καλύτερα ερωτήσεις αν μπορείτε, κυρία. Ναι, ελληνικά, όπως είπατε.
Καταλαβαίνω όλα.
Μπράβο. Θέλω να πω για τη λέξη φίλος ότι αρχικά είναι κτητική αντωνυμία και σημαίνει δικό μου. Μάλιστα.
Δικό μου, ναι. Αυτό είναι.
Μετά αγαπητός, οπότε εδώ πάει καλά να αποδοθεί ως μάλλον. Forever.
Σύμφωνο.
Μπορώ να ρωτήσω και εγώ κάτι. Δεν θα μπορούσαμε να το πούμε σύνθεση και αποσύνθεση. Συνθέτω και αποσυνθέτω.
Okay, I love the way you use the word synthesis, yes, because you are, yes, but you're almost, I'm complimenting you, a neo-Hegelian. in the sense that you have thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. And that is what Euripides is all about.
Thank you.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Άλλη ερώτηση. Σίγουρα. Τότε, χωρίς άλλες περιστροφές, να ευχαριστήσουμε τους ομιλητές μας. Thank you very much. Keith, Greg, Lanah, Keith, thank you very much indeed for integrating us once again.
You integrated us.
Thank you. Και σε όλους καλό βράδυ και σας ευχαριστούμε. Καλοτάξει τη συνεργασία μας με το εξωτερικό. Thank you.